We thank you, God, for this time once again that we're able to gather together around your word. Bless us now, we pray, in Jesus' name with thanksgiving. Amen and amen.
Amen.
All right. So we are continuing in this topic, waiting on the Lord. And what I want to do today is to focus in on what I'm calling mount up on wings of joy. And so, just in, okay, here we go. In terms of our, okay, I am not where I want to be. Hold up a minute. I think I got to go back. Okay, here we go. Here we go. All right. And so we have been talking about waiting on the Lord as you are going through to the other side. And Isaiah 40, 31, that we know so well, those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. And so, what we want to be looking at today is how that renewing of your strength, how joy plays a part in that. And that's why we're talking about mounting up on wings of joy. Okay, but before we get to the joy part, we just want to do a quick review of what we've been talking about the last several weeks. And what we've been saying is that there are three main ways in which we can go through to the other side. The first one is with despair, to be discouraged, fear, anger, bitterness, resentment. Going through, yes, but in just a feeling of despair. The second way is faltering with some ups and downs, some fear and then some faith and back and forth like a seesaw. And we saw that with Abram and Sarah. In Genesis 12, we saw them after they left Ur of the Chaldees, we saw them worship in Canaan where he built altars to the Lord and worshiped the Lord. But then, when the famine hit and it was time to go to Egypt to get food, now instead of worship, there is worry. He didn't build any altar, and now he is so worried about going into Egypt that he lied, turned to his wife to protect him with a lie. And as a result of that, they were expelled as persona non grata. And then in chapter 13, we see them leave Egypt and go back to Bethel. What? Why is that significant? Because Bethel is where they had built an altar to the Lord. And so again, now in Bethel, which literally means house of God, is where he again worships the Lord. So he's back in the faith mode. And then there we also see him separate from Lot, because remember that was an area in which he didn't completely obey God when he said, leave your family and your home. He took Lot with him. But now he separates from Lot and he moves to Hebron. And what does he do? Again, he builds an altar. And so now, full of faith, when Lot is taken in Genesis 14, he takes his 318 servants and he defeats a coalition of four armies with 300 men. And when he returns, he's blessed by Melchizedek. He communes with Melchizedek, who is a priest of God Most High. So this representative of God goes out and meets Abraham because of his faith and communes with him. And then, out of love and appreciation, Abram gives a tithe to Melchizedek. He's really giving it to God, through Melchizedek, who is God's representative as the king and priest. And of course, we know Melchizedek is a type of Christ. And then the very next chapter, though, what do we see is Abram complaining, God, Eliezer, my servant, is going to be my heir. You have not given me an heir. You have not fulfilled your promise. And so, what does God do to reassure Abraham? He cuts a covenant with actually the ceremony of cutting the animals and walking through the blood. And God does this to reassure Abram. And yet, by the time we get to the next chapter, chapter 16, what do we find? Despair and disaster, where Abram heeds Sarah's suggestion to have a son with Hagar. And that just causes all the problems that we still have today with the Arabs who came from Hagar and Ishmael. And so what we see is he is on a down part of the seesaw, lacking faith in God's covenant. So Abram and Sarah up and down, fear and faith, back and forth. All right. So we see them faltering. And in their faltering, one of the things we do not see is we do not see joy. We do not see joy. And so the third way in which we can go through to the other side as we are waiting on the Lord is to be unmovable and have unwavering faith. Now, this unwavering faith is more than just having a rigid, dogged determination. I believe God, and God is going to do this, and that's it. See, yeah, that is one way to be steadfast, but that's not really what we want. That's not what we're talking about. We are talking about this unwavering faith whose foundation is joy, because it is the joy of the Lord that is our strength. The joy of the Lord. So we want to be able to go through as we are waiting on the Lord to take us to the other side. We want to go through it with joy. And joy is different to happiness. Happiness is a feeling of pleasure that's based on the external circumstances. And these circumstances are temporary, so happiness goes up and down based on the situation. But not so with joy. Joy is an inner delight and contentment, regardless of the circumstances. And this joy is a long-lasting state of being. Why? Because the source of joy is from God Himself, and it is one of the fruit of the Spirit. And so, as a fruit, guess what? Joy has to be cultivated because it's not automatic that we are going to have joy as we are going through. So we have to cultivate that fruit of the Spirit, that joy, as we practice the habit of the Spirit, as we practice the unbroken awareness of the presence of God with us 24/7, then we are able to experience that joy as we are going through. And we can mount up on wings of joy. And so, what I want to do now is to share with us this song. I know you've heard it before. It's by Cece Winans. This song, that simply says, I've got joy. And so I want you to really listen to the words. They're going to be shown on the screen as well. And I want you to listen to the words that as they speak to us about being able to have joy as we are going through.
the struggle. I've got peace in the storm. I've got strength in the battle. I don't fear anymore. I'm a child of heaven, and my hope is secure. I've got joy, 'cause I've got Jesus. He gave me beauty for ashes, turned my life around. He broke my chains, and now I dance on solid ground. For all he's done to save me, I will raise my voice. I've got Jesus, so I've got joy. He bore all of my burdens, yeah, my debt has been paid. Then he said to my dry bones, rise up out of that grave. He has all of my worship, all the honor and praise. I've got joy, 'cause I've got Jesus.
I've got Jesus, so I've got joy. Oh my, that's such a beautiful song, but it's more than just a beautiful song. The words are so scriptural. And so I just want us to just look at the words and so that we can get our strength and our joy as we focus on these lyrics that come right from scripture. And I just love, love, love these words. I've got joy in the struggle. I've got peace in the storm. I've got strength in the battle. I don't fear anymore. I'm a child of heaven, and my hope is secure. I've got joy, 'cause I've got Jesus. He gave me beauty for ashes, turned my life around. He broke my chains, and now I dance on solid ground. For all he's done to save me, I will raise my voice. I've got Jesus, so I've got joy. So let's take a look at this. It starts off by saying, I've got joy in the struggle. And, you know, that comes right out of James chapter 1, which says, dear brothers and sisters, when troubles of any kind come your way, Consider it an opportunity for great joy. Oh my, oh my. Usually that's the last thing we want to focus on is an opportunity for great joy. But that's what James is saying, the word of God. And the reason is, he says, you know that when your faith is tested, that's what the troubles are, a test of our faith, your endurance has a chance to grow. So let it grow, for when your endurance is fully developed, you will be perfect and complete. In other words, you will be mature, a mature Christian, a mature disciple, needing nothing. And our example is Jesus himself, talking about joy in the struggle. That's what it tells us in Hebrews chapter 12. Let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. So each of us have a race to run, and that race requires endurance to keep on going, not getting weary, to be patient and not grow weary and give up. How do we run with endurance? By keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion, the one who initiates and perfects our faith. And look at this. This is the example he has set before us. Because of the joy awaiting him, listen, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. So, in other words, he was able to see beyond the cross. That's why he was able to say, nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done, because there was joy in you and me being the recipients of the salvation that he would give to the world by going to the cross. So he endured the difficulty, the shame of the cross. Why? Because there was joy, 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 joy. And so the result of his doing the will of the Father and going through to the end with joy, the result is that now he is seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. And the text says, think of all the hostility Jesus endured from sinful people. So when you think of that, then you and I won't become weary and give up when we look at the example of Jesus and what he endured with joy for us. So I've got joy in the struggle. But then it goes on to say, I've got peace in the storm. Yeah, Philippians 4, 6. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all he has done. And what's going to be the result? Then you and I will experience God's peace. The peace in the midst of the storm, which exceeds anything we can understand. King James says that passes all understanding. And it is his peace that will guard our hearts and minds as we live our lives in Christ Jesus. And again, we see Jesus as our supreme example in the storm at sea. We know about it. In Mark chapter 4, Jesus was asleep in the boat in the storm. I mean, this was a mega storm. And the disciples, these seasoned sailors, were afraid that they were going down and were going to drown and were going to perish. And so, how were they going through their storm? In despair. In despair. And so, they woke up Jesus with an accusation. Don't you care that we are going to perish? You don't even care about us. What is the matter with you? And the problem wasn't that there was something wrong with Jesus. it was something was wrong with them. And because Jesus wasn't following them in their despair, they accuse him of not caring for them. But Jesus had peace in the storm enough to be asleep during the height of the storm. So I've got joy in the struggle. I've got peace in the storm. And then it says, I've got strength in the battle. Psalms, right out of Psalms 28, verse 7. The Lord is my strength and shield. I trust him with all my heart. He helps me, and my heart is filled with what? Joy. There it is. My heart is filled with joy because the Lord is my strength and shield. And so, in the midst of the battle, I can burst out in songs of thanksgiving. And we see an example of this in Nehemiah 8, beginning at verse 8, which is when the people had returned from the 70 years Babylonian captivity, and they were back in the land, but they were not really doing the things that they ought to have been doing. And so Ezra and Nehemiah had gathered the people in the square, and they were reading from the book of the law and clearly explaining the meaning of what was being read, so that the people could understand each passage. And when they did, they realized that they were in disobedience and began to despair. They were dejected and sad because they were, oh my goodness, we might go back into captivity because of our disobedience. 1 minute. Okay, so, and so here now, Ezra the priest tells the people, don't be dejected and sad, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. That you need his strength in order to do what it is he has called you to do. So don't be dejected and sad, but take joy in the Lord who is your strength. And so the people went away to eat and drink at a festive meal, to share gifts of food, and to celebrate with great joy because they had heard God's words, they had understood them, and now they were ready to obey what the word of God was saying to them. All right? And that's where the joy gives us the strength to do what God's word says. And Jesus, he was able to do that. He found his strength of purpose in the Garden of Gethsemane, knowing and understanding God's will. He was able to say with joy, not my will, but your will be done. And the result, as the song tells us, because I've got joy in the struggle, peace in the storm, strength in the battle, the result, I don't fear anymore. Why not? I'm a child of heaven, a child of heaven, of the Most High God. And because of that joy, we can soar on eagle's wings of joy, mount up on wings of joy, because we are children of heaven. And my hope is secure. That's right. Our hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. We dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. So, The chorus, I've got joy because I've got Jesus. Isn't that wonderful? Joy, the source of our joy is Jesus. We got Jesus, so we got joy. We got joy in the struggle, peace in the storm, strength in the battle because we got Jesus and Jesus got you. oh my, isn't that just absolutely beautiful? And then the next verse, he gave me beauty for ashes. Again, right out of the scripture, Isaiah 61:3, to all who mourn in Israel, he will give a crown of beauty for ashes, a joyous blessing instead of mourning, festive praise instead of despair. Listen, that's what joy does. And so, because he is the one who gives us beauty for ashes, he turns our life around. We may still be going through, but it's okay because we know that we are going to come out on the other side in the end. Just like Job, he was restored double for his trouble. Just like Jesus, the humility of the cross that he endured led to him being highly exalted, sitting on his throne and being given a name that is above every other name. At his name, every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. That's what he does when we mount up on wings of joy. He gives us beauty for ashes, turns our life around. He broke my chains. Oh, yes, indeed. Psalms 137, verse 3, it talks about when they were in Babylonian captivity. And they were complaining. They said, our tormentors insisted we sing a joyful hymn. But how can we sing the songs of the Lord while we are here captive in a pagan land? But in Ezekiel 34, 27, God says, when I have broken their chains of slavery and rescued them from those who enslave them, then they will know that I am the Lord. Yes, God is the one who allowed them to be enslaved, but it is also the same God who broke their chains of slavery and rescued them and returned them back into the land that he had promised to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And now, as a result of giving beauty for ashes and turning the lives around and breaking their chains, and now we, you and I, dance on solid ground. Listen, I just love it. Not just standing on solid ground, but dancing like David danced before the Lord. Dancing on solid ground. Listen, we're talking about mounting up on wings of joy. Joy, the joy of the Lord, which is our strength. Habakkuk 3:18, I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in the God of my salvation. Why? Because the sovereign Lord is my strength. He is the one who makes me sure-footed as a deer, able to tread, to dance upon the heights, upon the top of the mountain, on the mountaintop. We can dance on solid ground for all that he has done to save me. We know we're going to be celebrating that our communion on Sunday. All he's done to save me, his humility on taking on human flesh, being born of a virgin, willingly suffering and dying for our sins, all that he went through. Because of that, I will raise my voice. That's right. We can't help but sing and shout and give praise and glory unto God's name for all that he has done. I will raise my voice. We will raise our voice because we got Jesus all day, every day in our hearts. He is there. And because he is with us 24/7, regardless of the circumstances, we know that he is with us. We've got Jesus, and so we've got joy. As a matter of fact, listen, with all of this, it is impossible not to have joy. How could you not have joy when you got Jesus, when your focus is on him instead of the circumstances? The circumstances doesn't determine our joy. Our joy is found in Jesus. And so we can mount up on wings of joy and soar, soar as we are going through, as opposed to flapping our energy, wasting energy, trying to do things our way. We can soar with joy as we go through, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. And then the next part of the song, he bore all of my burdens. Yeah, my debt has been paid. Then he said to my dry bones, rise up out of that grave. He has all of my worship, all the honor and praise. I've got joy because I've got Jesus. So let's take a look at that. He bore all of my burdens. Well, that's no mystery at all. 1 Peter 5:7, he says, give all your worries, your cares, your burdens to the Lord because he cares about you. Isn't that wonderful? I mean, who else says that? Hey, give me all your problems, give me all your cares, give me all your burdens. I got you. Hey, no one else but God says that. And of course, Jesus bore the greatest burden, our greatest burden, the burden of sin. He bore that on the cross. And as a result, our debt has been paid. The wages of sin is debt, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus the Christ. And so now we can rejoice in our wonderful new relationship with God because Jesus has made us friends of God, because he has paid the debt that keeps us separated from God. Now we have relationship with God. Our debt has been paid. We are friends, children of the Most High God. And then, I love this. He said to my dry bones, because sometimes we can't feel that way. Rise up out of that grave. What are you doing there? No, rise up, mount up on wings of eagles, on wings of joy. Ezekiel 37, God asks Ezekiel, son of man, can these dry bones become living people again? Can they live again? The dry bones representing the death that comes from the problems and the situations that we are going through. Can they live again? Can they become better even than what they were before? And Ezekiel was like, I don't know, only you know, Lord. And so God gave him these instructions. Speak a prophetic message to these bones. Speak over your situation. Speak to the problem. Speak God's word over your situation. And what were those words? Dry bones. Listen to the word of the Lord. I am going to put breath into you and make you live again. Then you will know that I am the Lord. And what did Ezekiel do? He did what God told him to do. He spoke to the dry bones. He spoke to the situation. And what happened? Exactly what he said would happen is exactly what happened, because that's what God said would happen. Listen, God's word is true. And so we speak God's word as we are going through. We speak and we say what God has said to the situation. It looks bad. The dry bones scattered in the valley. It doesn't seem possible. But God says, speak his word over the impossible situation, and nothing shall be impossible to you. And what's the result? He has all of my worship. Yeah. Every day we practice the habit of the Spirit. We spend time sitting still, praying, inhaling, taking in God's goodness, reading the word, inquiring of the Spirit, and thanking God for all that he has already done and all that he is going to do. So he has all of our worship, all the honor and praise. We got joy because we got Jesus. And I like this. Jesus, you can call, the Bible says he's a friend that sticks closer than a brother. And I like to say he's a friend with benefits. We got a lot of benefits from our friend Jesus. And then it goes on to say in the next verse, joy like a river running through my soul. Oh my, again, that is right out of the word of God. Joy like a river running through my soul. In John 7, 37, it was the last day of the Feast of Tabernacles. And this Feast of Tabernacles was a week-long celebration where they built little tents, they call them booths, and they would live in them during that week of the feast, the festival. And the reason for that, it was to remind them of when they were traveling through the wilderness, those 40 years, and they were living in tents, and how God was their provision, giving them water and food all those years that they were in the wilderness. And so on the last day of this feast, Jesus stood up and shouted to the crowds, anyone who is thirsty may come to me. Remember, that was one of their complaints. We don't have any water. We don't have any water. We don't have any water. What are we going to do? And so Jesus says, anyone who is thirsty, come to me. Anyone who believes in me may come and drink. For the scriptures declare, rivers of living water will flow from your heart, from your soul. That's what he's talking about. Joy like a river, these living waters, rivers of living water running through our soul. He is the source of the joy that flows in our hearts like a river. That's why he was able to tell the woman at the well in John 4, the water I give you becomes a fresh, bubbling spring flowing from within. The source is internal of this living water. It's joy like a river running through our soul. Joy all around, everywhere we go. Yes, listen, joy is pervasive. It's with you everywhere. Why? Because Jesus is with you everywhere. And Jesus is the source of joy. So joy is everywhere we go, regardless of the situation, regardless of the circumstance. His promise is, I will never leave you nor forsake you. It is a divine guarantee. tea. And then, not only just everywhere we go, but just to put a fine point on that everywhere, it says, even in the desert, still it overflows. That's right. Isaiah 43:20. I will make rivers in the dry wasteland so my chosen people can be refreshed. So, yes, even in the desert, in the worst of circumstances, still joy overflows like a river overflowing its banks, running through your soul. So, the result of this joy of mounting up on wings of joy is that we can emphatically declare, oh, I've got joy. Yes, it's a certainty. So we say, yes, I've got joy. I've got joy never ending. Never ending. This river of joy that never stops because it's internal. The source is from God. It's internal. It's bubbling up. It's a spring, an internal spring that does not end because God never ends. He is eternal. Joy never ending. Why? Because he called my name, your name. That's what he says. In Isaiah 43, I have called you by name. You are mine. Not only that, but he says in Isaiah 49, your name is written in the palm of God's hands. That's right. He's called your name. He's written your name. He knows you by name, and he declares you belong to him. So, as a result of that, of all that he has given to us, we declare, like the psalmist says, every breath I breathe is a testament of his amazing grace. Yes, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. So, we give him the praise out of a joyful heart. It is his amazing grace that he gives us new mercies every single morning. Great is his faithfulness. And so it says, oh, hallelujah, the highest praise. Everything has changed. That's right. Everything has changed. Listen, even though the circumstances may not have changed, everything has changed internally because we can mount up on wings of joy. Everything has changed. Mourning has turned to dancing. And we have a garment of praise instead of a spirit of heaviness. Everything has changed because we have the joy of the Lord, which is our strength. Ha! Wait on the Lord and be of good courage. Wait, I say, on the Lord and mount up on wings of joy, for the joy of the Lord is indeed your strength. It is my strength. It is our strength. And so we go forward in faith, in the joy and the strength of the Lord our God. Amen, amen, amen. Whew. Oh, hallelujah. Glory to God. Whew. Glory, 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 glory. All right, I'm done, y'all. So, if there are any comments, questions, takeaways, how has God maybe spoken to your heart as you may be going through your circumstance, and how God may have encouraged your heart as a result of tonight?
Well, I got joy.
Amen. You got Jesus. You got joy. Amen.
I got Jesus. I got joy like a river.
Oh, Lord, have mercy.
I needed that. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Joy, joy like a river running through my soul, my spirit, my heart, my body. Woo. Glory,
Yes.
glory, 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 glory. I tell you, that song has just, I've just been listening to that
Good.
song over and over and over again, and it has just been so inspiring, so inspiring. And so God just led me to share that with us on today, to just lift up our spirits, to mount up on wings of joy as we continue to serve the Lord as we go through over to the other side.
Hallelujah. Yeah, that was good.
Amen.
Ooh, that
Those
was
that sow
good
in
to me.
tears will reap in joy. Amen. 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 Amen.
Awesome.
Praise the
Ooh.
Lord. God.
Dr. Dennery,
Yes, sir.
I thank you for tonight's word because I spent this afternoon talking to a cousin who's medical doctor, but she's working on her dissertation on in Virginia. And she's spending a lot of time working at a residential facility in which children who are estranged from their parents are housed. And many of them have identity crisis around race, around family, around gender. And what keeps on coming up in terms of the family is a spirit of depression that is attacking families and marriages and relationships between brothers and sisters. One of the things that came out of the conversation is that people will be in the same room at the dinner table and everybody will be on a phone. And that people are really in a situation now of giving up financially, emotionally. There's deep enmity and strife in congregations in between families. And very many people will feel alone. And so your word today about joy and about the capacity to use words to speak, to change your circumstance, to change your conditions. We're doing a word study at church, 40-day fast about the power of the tongue. So important because you're helping us to use words, and even in the song and in your preaching, that we can use words if we have joy to change our condition and to emerge as champions. But there's a spirit of depression and alienation and bitterness that attacks people regardless of how they present themselves on the outside. And my prayer up out of your teaching tonight is that we don't just have joy in the church, but the church itself knows as is known as the marketplace, the repository, the citadel of joy, that throughout from the beginning to end, a spirit of joy takes over. And it does not say that you're not going to have tears, but it says you in your tears you can still sow and then you reap in joy. So joy can be both the producer of your life and it can also be what is produced by a good life. I don't know if that makes sense. That joy shapes your reality, but there are some things that you can do to even get joy in the first place.
So thank you so much.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. God is good. That's just what God just put that in on my heart, just so powerfully to share, on tonight, to really just to encourage the saints, and just using this song that has been just so beautifully put together using God's word. And that's the beauty, just using God's word to sing God's word to our spirit and to our soul, so that as you are listening to that song, and I just hope that you would, listen to that song, and as you hear it, that it would permeate the depths of your soul,
Yes,
so that
yes,
faith
yes.
will come, because faith comes
Yes.
by hearing God's
Yes.
word. And the beauty is that it is the song is God's word set to music. Oh my, how
Hallelujah.
beautiful
Hallelujah.
and how powerful. And that's what the Psalms are. We all love the Psalms, and the Psalms are actually songs. They were sung. They were the hymn book of ancient Israel. And so we can use these spirit-generated songs that can really lift us up and help us to be able to move forward in joy, in faith, in the strength of the Lord, with His joy that He gives to us. And the thing is that we have to cultivate the joy. It doesn't happen automatically. And one of the ways we can cultivate this joy is by hearing God's word about joy and allowing that joy to spring forth in our hearts to help us as we are going through to the other side, to be able to go through with the strength of the Lord found in His joy. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Hey,
Woo, man.
Dr.
Yes,
Dennering.
yes, Michelle.
Dr. Dennering, this is
Go ahead.
Michelle.
Yes.
Hey, so the devil tried to steal my joy this evening because my clock in my den said 10 minutes after 6. So what I was actually doing was reviewing last week's session on my laptop, getting ready for this week because it was so good last week until Teresa texted me, said, "Where are you at?" I said, "It was only 10 minutes after 6, 10 minutes after 6." Realizing that I was late. Didn't even realize it. So the devil tried to steal my joy. So I need you to send that to me.
Yes, ma'am.
All
Amen.
righty.
Praise the
Yes.
Lord. This is
Yeah.
Reverend
I'm
Dr. Duvet.
disappointed. I'm disappointed. Oh, go ahead.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm waiting till you finish.
No, go ahead. I'm sorry.
This is Reverend Dr. Duvet from Philadelphia. Praise
Yes.
God for your wonderful, insightful teaching. I just wanted to say I always love anything that you're teaching about, but joy is one of my favorite pieces of the word, because it tells us in Ephesians to speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. So I always say Jesus, others, and yourself. If you got Jesus and you love others as yourself, that's J-O-Y, joy. And we
Amen.
have to know, if we don't have the joy of the Lord, if we don't display the joy of the Lord as the people of God, why would others want to serve a God if we're walking around with long faces? I
Yes.
mean, this is what draws people
Say
in. This is what draws
Hallelujah.
people in, is that they see the joy of the Lord. We are the living epistles. We're the written
Yes.
epistle. So they may not read the Bible, but they read you. And what they see
Lord.
in you is what they say. Why is this person, even in the midst of sadness, even in the midst of trials, you still
Amen.
have the joy of the Lord? Because the joy of the Lord emanates from above. It doesn't come from outside. It comes from above. And see, people are looking for happiness and all these things that are coming from other entities. But we know that joy is something God deposits in us, a fruit of the
Yes.
Spirit. So I thank you so much for that teaching, that more of us understand that we have to show the joy of the Lord. That is such a key for winning others to Christ. Because
Yeah,
this is like, if
amen.
you're walking around and you're sad all the time and you got Jesus, the answer to everything.
And you are no reason for us to be walking around with long faces. So I praise God for this and continue your teaching. I'm praying for you as you engage the body of Christ to be a hearer of the word, I mean, a doer of the word and not just a hearer. Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
The Lord. Bless the Lord. Amen. God is good. I tell you. Well, if there's no other comments, Pastor, could you just go ahead? The one who just spoke, could you just go ahead and close us out in prayer, please?
Oh, praise the Lord. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
That's Dr. Ham. Amen.
Hallelujah. We just praise you. We thank you, God, for this time of fellowship, this time of learning, this time of engaging with your word. God, we thank you, oh God, that even sometimes if we wrestle in the spirit, God, we know that you have the final word in our lives. So we thank you today, God, for what you're doing in our life. Let that joy come forth as bubbling in from the inside out, oh God, like rivers of living water. In the name of Jesus, we declare and decree that we will have the joy. The joy unspeakable and full of glory. The joy, oh God, the joy that you give to us, oh God. You said that the joy of the Lord is our strength. So we're walking around, oh God, because we're not concerned about the things of this earth. You said set our affections on things above. Oh God, so I thank you today, God, that we will walk in joy. Hallelujah. Thank you for Dr. Dennery, for teaching, oh God, and for all that assembled on the line, meet our needs according to your riches and glory through Christ Jesus. God, I thank you. I praise you, Lord God. We're going to walk in joy. We're going to talk in joy. Oh God, we're going to live in joy. Hallelujah. Yes. Glory to your name, God. Hallelujah.
Glory,
I thank you,
glory.
Oh God, for the joy. God, we give you all the glory. We give you all the praise, all the honor. It belongs to you and you alone. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Glory.
Amen.
Glory.
Amen.
Glory.
Amen.
Glory.
Glory. Hallelujah. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Thank
you. Amen. 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 Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me.
Hallelujah.
He's all right.
Bless the Lord. Thank you all so much. God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you. Bless everybody. Love you guys.
What a word. What a prayer.
God bless.
Good night.
Have a good night. Have a good evening.
All right. God bless you. Bye-bye now.
Bye.